and with vast degrees of experience in this particular field. And the best part is they'll try to keep their presentations as basic so as to be it's receptive to majority of the participants, because the motto of our association is that the sensitization towards the practice of chronic pain and cancer pain, etc., that should increase. And really this discipline as a specialized discipline could be the future. And having said that, I once again welcome all our speakers. Dr. Shailesh Mishra, he is joining us live from Newcastle. And Dr. Rajendra Sahu is joining us from Bhuneshwar. And carry forward the proceedings, I welcome the chairperson for the evening, Dr. Ritesh Roy. He is a senior consultant and academic in charge at Care Hospital Bhuvaneshwar. Over to you, Dr. Roy.
Thank you, Jita. Thank you, ISSP branch Bhuvaneshwar. So, continuing with the webinar series, this is the last webinar of this year, and the year which everyone wants to forget. And next year, 2021, will bring joys to each one of us, and we will continuing our webinar next year. So without wasting any time, we are going to discuss two very important topics. The first topic will be on the chronic post-operative pain, and we are very fortunate to have Dr. Shailesh Mishra. He is a person from our own state, but settled in UK right now. So Dr. Shailesh Mishra, he completed his MBBS from MKCG Medical College in Orissa, then completed MD and senior residency in anesthesia from AIIMS, New Delhi. He went to UK in 2003 and underwent further specialized training before becoming a consultant in NHS UK anesthesia and pain management in 2011 in Newcastle. He's a lecturer in Newcastle University and a member of Faculty of Pain Medicine Professional Standards Committee. His field of interest is acute pain, neuropathic pain, opioids, and pain education. Apart from a medicine specialist and a pain physician, he is also a radio presenter as RJ Shailesh and a keen photographer. Welcome to you, Dr. Shailesh Mishra. And thanks to Anesthesia TV and Pain TV and Rahul, this webinar is being telecasted live on YouTube and Facebook, and it is all over the world it's being transmitted. So over to you, Dr. Shailesh, for your presentation. I will request all the participants to keep your phone in a your mic in a mute mode. Any question, you can just type in the chat box. Over to you, Dr. Shailesh. Thank you.
Thank you, Ritesh. Thank you. Thank you for that generous introduction. And am I audible? Can I just check with everyone? Am I audible clearly? And can you see the front screen?
Yeah, it's all right.
Okay. Visible. Okay. Lovely. Great. Okay. Okay. So the topic that I'm going to present today is chronic post-surgical pain, and basically my job as a doctor is I'm a consultant in anesthesia and pain management. So I do give anesthetics, which includes doing flaps, breast flaps, other LD or other flaps. And then I also do spine list, and I'm a neuroanesthetist as well. But also I do pain management, and I do both acute and chronic pain management. Now you'll have a lot of people who are anesthetists and they do some acute pain management. And there are a lot of chronic pain management guys who do either don't do any anesthetics or do very little anesthetics, or probably don't do acute pain. But luckily for me, I have had that spectrum, anesthesia, then acute pain sorting out, and then people going into chronic pain. So I've had that journey. So, and then when acute pain becomes sort of posh, it becomes chronic, it becomes inpatient pain. So not only you are sorting out people's post-operative pain, but you are also sorting out people who are admitted in the hospital because of pain flare-up. So people with chronic pain problem who have got acute flare-up, people with fibromyalgia who have got acute flare-up, people with chronic abdominal pain who have got acute flare-up, and they're admitted. And you're in there in the hospital, you're basically doing your round and you're seeing and sorting them out. And then I'm also, obviously, chronic pain is the bread and butter stuff. So chronic pain clinic, chronic pain intervention, and cancer pain management and cancer pain intervention. So that's kind of the range. And I am lucky that I got trained in India fully in anesthetic. I was almost finishing my senior residency. So that's 3+3, almost 6 years of training in AIMS. And then I went up to UK and had another 7 years of training. So therefore, I had almost 13 years of training before becoming a consultant, just in anesthesia and pain management. And therefore, I try to give that back by sort of teaching, and I'm keen for education, and I'm a lecturer in the university and in a few other committees that I have my role. One of the things that I will say in the time of, I noticed Jita's background, COVID pandemic numbers, and how the new strain, the yesterday's news is that basically we are having a new strain of COVID and that has hit London, and we are now again probably heading for another lockdown sort of thing. So when life is not sure, we don't know how we can plan, and this 2020, the year it has been, one of the things that you can look for is Tim Minchin, a guy who gives this nice talk. And one of the things that, be a teacher. So I'm glad that you have taken this initiative, and I'm glad that you are kind of doing all these webinars in the time of COVID, so that the knowledge sharing is continuing. So that's a very good thing to do, actually. I wanted to say, we are no longer anesthetist or anesthesiologist, as the Americans say, only. We have become kind of perioperative physicians. So no longer the job is go to the operating theater, do the procedure, look after the patient, go to send to recovery, and there you go, your job is finished. We are now getting more and more involved in their care before and after the surgery, and much beyond after surgery. So even if you're not a pain doctor, you will have a lot to kind of offer to the patient in the journey before the operation and much after the operation as well. So just keep that in mind. So what I'm going to talk, basically chronic post-surgical pain, how, why, when, how much, how do we recognize, assess, and treat, what can our surgical colleagues do to sort out this pain, this problem, and what we can do as anesthesiologists, as perioperative physicians, and also as interventional pain specialists, chronic, those of you who are doing chronic pain. So with that, just to give you a bit of overview, we don't actually look for it that often. In a real world, in a perfect world, if we were to have an operation, then okay, people will have a bit of pain, and then the pain will settle down, and hopefully by 3 months, big laparotomy, little bit of ache here and there, everything sorted, gone. Okay, fantastic. But in the reality that we live, your surgical colleague does a fantastic operation, and then most of the people, the pain will settle down, but there will be a cohort of people where the pain will continue even 3 months, 6 months, 12 months after surgery. So that is chronic post-surgical pain. I mean, so many times you would have seen a relative who has had a caesarean section and says, oh, I've got a little bit of ache here, a little bit of thing. Somebody who has had a perfect hernia repair with a mesh repair and saying, oh, I've got a little bit of numbness and a little bit of pain going down to my groin, but that's fine. My hernia is okay. So, but no, it's not okay. It's just that we haven't looked for it, and we haven't given it a sticker. So what we do know now, if acute pain is, you know, the people, your physiology is good, your pain is serving a sign there. So it is acute cholecystitis, acute appendicitis. Yes, we need that pain. That pain is good. But if we don't manage it well, that becomes chronic pain. In acute pain, your physiology is unaltered, but in chronic pain, your physiology is all over the place. This is serving is a warning signal, but this is just being a pain. It's kind of a useless pain. That is chronic pain. So it is important to know that, but now we know that a badly managed acute pain leads to chronic pain. So that is where we can stop. Even if you are not a pain doctor, as an anesthetist, you can do a lot. So when talking about people who have done a lot of work, Kehlet is the European surgeon who has done a lot of work around that. So he started looking first time in basically chronic in 2000 that see the number of people who have got chronic post-surgical pain 1 year pain following the procedure, storm pain, look at the bubble, 6 out of 10, 60%, phantom pain, thoracotomy pain, none of them are like 10 or 20%. They are all like more than 10, 20%. Okay, hernia, gallbladder pain, some of them as high as up to 8 out of 10, 80, 90% people have got pain following that. Okay, anesthesia is improving and our pain management is improving. So have things changed? 2006, again, he looked at it. Still high number of cases. Still 30 to 50% cases, incidence of chronic pain. See, chronic pain has made so much strides, but we just haven't looked at this aspect at much at all, and we haven't done much over the period of time. Another 5 years goes, 2011 now, incident of amputation pain, thoracotomy pain, mastectomy pain, still continues all this number. You see, that nothing much has changed over the years. People are still experiencing chronic pain after these operations. So therefore, now the question is, what is this type of pain then? This is a predominantly neuropathic pain. And how do we know that? Because the patient will come and tell you, all you have to do is just ask, and people will have symptoms of sensitivity to touch, allodynia, or maybe hyperalgesia, altered sensation, paresthesia, and it will be following the distribution of a nerve. So it is pretty easy to diagnose actually. And then who are the people who are likely to be having this sort of pain? Well, we can almost identify these are the people who are very likely to have pain even after the surgery, even after the surgical correction has been done, because sometimes they have just got chronic pain to start off with. And they're coming in for a repeat surgery, they have got psychological vulnerability, they have got anxiety. Somehow female people get a bit more than male, young people get more than adult. And if there's a compensation going on, then that becomes even more another psychological aspect that are giving distress. And then to be fair to the patient, sometimes we have our radiation, the chemotherapy, depression and anxiety, all this itself also contributes to this pain. So just to build up, the risk factor, now this has been, this is the book, Acute Pain Scientific Evidence, which is produced by the Australia and New Zealand Society of Anesthesia and Pain Management. We call it the Acute Pain Bible. And the new edition is coming soon. And this is the latest edition, which is available currently to download. You can download it from internet. So there is a lot of association between anxiety, catastrophizing, and all that with chronic post-surgical pain. And some of my slides. Other risk factor development of psychological factor and the injury of nerve during the time of surgery. So just to summarize all that we discussed, there is a Redmi Note 9, which is affecting the coming up to the slide and the screen. Okay, right. So therefore, progression of pain, 1 month and less than 1 month, it is fine, but then if it is gone on for more than 3 to 6 months, that is what is causing chronic pain. Okay. And then, in other words, this nice article which has come up basically, which says that age, anxiety, genetics, surgical techniques, anesthetic techniques, they all affect how the pain is perceived in the development of chronic post-surgical pain. So the question is, we know now it happens. There is enough data to say it is happening. And just to bring you to, for those of you who are keen on definitions, pain that is developing after surgery, pain which was not there before the surgery and has been there for at least 2 to 3 months after surgery, and we have ruled out other causes of pain like malignancy or infection. And this is what is chronic post-surgical pain. Just to be, because when you keep using the word CPSP, sometimes people can get it confused with CRPS. We are talking of completely different things. CRPS, all of you know that, complex regional pain syndrome and debilitating condition. So we're not talking about CRPS, we're talking about CPSP or chronic post-surgical pain. The question is then, in a world where you are doing a lot of private practice, medical legal litigations are there, are we actually explaining the patient that there's a possibility that even after your operation, you will continue to be in pain? Well, it is said that if something is common or very common, we should actually be saying that very common is 1 in 10, common is 1 in 100. And we found out how 30, 40, 80% of people can have pain. Yet, when we actually take consent, I did an audit there, we are not actually, so it is not actually even discussing about that there's a chance of having pain. So it is a advice to your surgical colleagues to tell them that actually do mention in your consent form that even after this procedure, there is a chance to have some percentage of chronic post-surgical pain that is remaining. Actually, as senior doctors, we are bad. Actually, your junior doctors, they are better in explaining pain and taking consent. Okay, so we have a problem. How do we manage? Don't operate. Well, that is not realistic all the time, but sometimes it can be. And so risk-benefit, discuss. I mean, if somebody is having a vasectomy, a cosmetic breast surgery, a stable low-risk hernia, do we really need to operate if we know the risk of pain persisting after the surgery could be as much as 20, 30, 40%? I mean, I have had young guys having vasectomy, and their life has been completely wrecked because of the post-operative pain that they have got, they're continuing, and completely their life has been wrecked with what is elective surgery. So, and some people, you can almost flag that they are going to be difficult because they have got visceral hypersensitivity syndrome, they have got IBS, they have got migraine, they have got fibromyalgia, and they have already on high dose of opioids. So those people will be tricky in doing this surgical technique. It has been seen actually that techniques, obviously, when you put a mesh, it leads to works as a source of inflammation. So actually, it irritates. So you find a hernia repair without mesh, probably the chance of chronic post-surgical pain is less, but a hernia repair with mesh will have a much higher chance of chronic post-surgical pain. So this is something to be aware of thing. So, and then nerve preservation technique, whether we cut the nerve or don't cut the nerve, it's been seen that there's incidence of chronic post-surgical pain. Right. So, and then obviously post-op complication, you have got infection, hematoma, you are re-exploding, you are redoing re-surgery, you are going back to operate on the same area. Again, that person 3 months later is saying that I've got a lot of pain in that area. As anesthetist, what can we do to reduce chronic post-surgical pain? Actually, the answer is quite a lot we can do. So think of spinal anesthetics, which obviously I know you all practice quite a lot. So extended epidural analgesia for thoracotomy, colorectal amputation, spinal diamorphin. I know in India, I don't know if it is available or not. Diamorphin is just twice stronger than morphine. So you give, normally in incision section, we would give 300 microgram or 0.3 milligram. But in infra-umbilical surgery, you can give up to as much as 1 milligram. And recently, some other hospitals have started giving up to 1.5 milligram, a very high dose, because it's a lot of itching, but works really well for at least 18 to 24 hours after the surgery, you almost to the point where you don't need to put an epidural. So, and then obviously there is paravertebral catheter, single salt, and you can do for mastectomies or traumatic refractures. And we know with the next speaker is going to talk a lot about regional anesthesia, so I'm not going to talk a lot about that. But then you have got tab block, rectus sheath, wound infusor, and all that is coming in. And then there are medicines. There are medicines that you can do for reducing the incidence of chronic post-surgical pain. So if we just simply, if you are teaching somebody, I'm sorry, got a phone call with no caller ID. Hello? Yeah, I'm sorry, I'll just call you back. Sorry, yeah. Sorry, there was no caller ID, so sometimes it can be urgent, so I just had to take it. So therefore, if we say, so basically, if we see the site of action of agents, then actually we just see that you have a nerve going in there and you put in a local anesthetic there. You have a nerve going further up, you put in a nerve block there. And then you have got dorsal root ganglia, you give some opioid, you give some dexmedetomidine, clonidine there. And then furthermore, on the cerebral cortex, sensory cortex, you're giving again opioids, alpha 2 adrenergic agonist. And then this descending modulator pathway is where SSRI and SNRI, so the tricyclics, the duloxetine, and they all work in that area. And then, so that is the path of, if you see the path of the nerve and then where you are blocking it. So that's all it is really. And then we know about the number needed to treat. Now, pain management medicines, you can give opioids all you want. It has a role in nociceptive pain, but post-surgical pain has got an inflammatory component. We need an anti-inflammatory. And of the four groups of medicines that you can think of, paracetamol, anti-inflammatories, anti-neuropathics, opioids, the group that stands the test of time is the anti-inflammatories. They have the best NNT. So think why we cannot give anti-inflammatory for 3 to 5 day course. And then often we say that, okay, we don't need it after a day or two, but maybe we need to keep it a little bit longer. And then there is all of those fancy stuff, ketamine, pregabalin, gabapentin, IV lidocaine, and all that sort of stuff. I'm not going to bore you, and I'm conscious of the time. I lost track of it a bit. So ketamine does help. It helps in reducing the wind-up phenomena. And therefore, if you haven't, now I know that a lot of us use ketamine in perioperative pain management and as an IV induction agent, but even if you are not inducing with ketamine, it has a role. And the forest plot clearly says that it has a role and it has helped actually. So for my neuro cases that I'm doing, so basically two or more spine surgeries, they have already got high opioid, they have got COPD, sleep apnea, and all this sort of thing. So, and then how do I manage? So basically, just to give you an overview of a case example technique. So basically, I would continue their pre-op antineuropathics and whatever they are on. And if they haven't got already, start them on a bit of pregabalin. Now, 150 twice daily is what the different studies have been quoted, but I know that Indian population, Asian population can be very sensitive. So maybe 75 twice daily, or even 75 one dose, even 4 hour or 1 hour before surgery will give you something to fall back on. And you can continue it for 3 to 4 days after surgery and see the response. And then explain, and then midazolam before induction, because that actually reduces all the hallucinogenic or all the psychomimetic effect of ketamine. And then ketamine is 0.5 milligram per kg bolus, followed by 0.25 milligram per kg per hour infusion. And when the surgeon is stitching, you switch it off. And then if you do that, actually, and then you can continue whichever anesthetic you are doing, your gas and volatile or TIVA anesthetics. And lidocaine bolus infusion is another thing. And then I'm giving some morphine at the end. Right. Okay. I'm going to skip through some slides because I'm mindful of other speakers are waiting. And just another 5 minutes, Jita, if I can have. Okay. Regional anesthesia. Now, that is, we're talking about epidural, but epidural used to be the gold standard. But the problem with epidural now is that when you have epidural, often people get hypotensive, then you are giving them a lot of fluids, and then you have, sometimes the surgeons will say that my anastomosis is leaking, and then I do not want that much of fluid. I want to keep the patient crispy, so that sort of thing. And therefore, epidural is open to interpretation. Something somewhere like UK, you have to have, they have to go to HDU or to a specialized monitoring ward. So there is issues around epidural, but then regional anesthesia, you can do all these blocks. And I know Ritesh and a lot of workshops are happening in Orissa, and so there's a lot of blocks are happening, and so you can get really good about these blocks and doing them actually. So therefore, and we can talk more about that. Then we're talking about the other stuff is IV lidocaine. Well, lidocaine we're using all the time. The thing is that one of the Indian guy who is in Canada, Navin Aipe, he has done some amazing work around lidocaine infusions, and he finds it is really good. Simple to remember, 1 to 2 milligram per kg bolus, 1 to 2 milligram per kg per hour infusion. And only thing remember, don't do it without ECG monitoring, please. Now, there has been deaths in the UK following IV lidocaine infusion. The golden sentence is no ECG, no IV lidocaine. You have to have ECG monitoring, to otherwise the whole hospital, you have one bad death and the whole hospital gets a bad name and that sort of thing. But that has got a lot of, promising things, particularly for complex gynecological, urological, spine surgery. It has a laparotomies and that sort of thing. So again, that's IV lidocaine. And then talking a bit about gabapentin and pregabalin, it's a bit of a judgment call whether you want to give them or not. Forest plot says that they are helping, and clearly you can see this speaks for itself that it favors use of. And the new opioid scientific, the new acute pain scientific evidence is also saying that we can use them actually. They're back again. Okay, so this is from 2015, but actually the 2020 is getting edited. I just had reviewed some chapters and it is coming back. Yeah, right. Okay, basically, so all I'm saying is chronic post-surgical pain is a chronic pain, and chronic pain management is 4 P's, pills. Think of your pills, different types of pills that you have got, all your anti-inflammatories, anti-neuropathics, because remember, there is a big neuropathic component of pain here. And then you can talk about opioids, but be cautious about opioids. Don't prescribe them in long term and just evaluate it. And in India, I know tramadol, tapentadol, you can give, and then morphine is a bit tricky to get. But then with tramadol, trapendol are not weak opiates. They're pretty strong and pretty addicting as well. So therefore, just have a think about it. And then procedures, all the nerve blocks, different sort of stuff we can do. I can tell about that. And then physiotherapy is another thing. If you are building up a good pain team, make sure that you have got access to physiotherapy and you have also got access to psychology. That's the key thing. So those are the two key things. So basically with that, just towards the last slide, is that some of the blocks are very simple to perform. And actually, I'll just tell you about that, that actually ilioinguinal hernia, nice mesh repair, ilioinguinal nerve knit, gentofemoral nerve knit, vasectomy surgery. And I have got people who have done this block and they have found it very gratifying. So ilioinguinal, gentofemoral, shoulder surgery, shoulder pain. Sometimes we joint into the shoulder joint, inject steroid into the shoulder joint, but the pain is actually suprascapular distribution. Suprascapular nerve block will be pretty good actually. And there'll be gratifying patients that area. And then often you'll find that a big thoracotomy, the thoracotomy scar will be okay, but actually it's the drain. The drains are because of that bursting through suture that we have been taught to do. I mean, somehow I find that people have got more drain site insertion. This pain is more painful than the scar pain from here. And then you have got ankle pain, and then you have got meralgia parasthenica, L1 nerve distribution pain, and you can do blocks here. So all these blocks are fairly simple to do, and you will have a lot of gratifying patients. The key thing is, and I have had patients of caesarean section where they, again, the ilioinguinal, gentofemoral nicked on both sides, and then I would do this on both block on both sides. So summary, recognize we can make a difference whether we are anesthetists, our perioperative physicians or pain physicians. Adjuvants have a role, nerve blocks have a role, and basically educate the patient, take consent, document in the consent that chronic pain is a possibility even after your surgery. And that's about it. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Sailesh, for a very nice, crisp presentation on the chronic post-operative surgical pain. And basically, it was a topic which needed something to be enlightened upon, because we just take care of the acute pain part, and what happens post-operative to the patient and after discharge, obviously that part we usually don't take care of that. Thank you. After this talk, I think we as an acute pain physician will try to follow up that chronic part which comes up. Dr. Sailesh, if possible, we can we take the questions after the session
of course,
Dr. Rajan?
Yeah. Please, of course.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you once again. So coming to the next speaker, he is our own Dr. Rajendra Sahu. He did his MBBS in 2004, MD in 2010. Then he did his regional anesthesia fellowship from Ganga Hospital in 2011 and a pain fellowship in Hyderabad in 2013. After that, he moved to Toronto to do his pain fellowship from the University of Toronto, Canada. And again, he did a musculoskeleton and pain ultrasound diploma from ASRA. And he's a pain physician having two ultrasound diplomas. He has 33 publications in peer-reviewed journal, and he has contributed four chapters in four books. He's a faculty in many national and international conferences, and presently he's working as a senior consultant pain and palliative care department of anesthesia, KIMS, Bhubaneswar. Welcome, Dr. Rajendra Sahu. He will be speaking on ultrasound in pain management, what's new. Over to you, Dr. Rajendra Sahu, please.
Yes, bhai, thank you very much for the kind introduction. Am I audible to everybody?
Audible, Rajendra, you can carry forward.
Okay. Dr. Mishra, it was wonderful. It was fantastic. You nicely covered all aspects of CPSP and everything. So actually, I didn't know about the theme of the meeting. So when friend Sovan told me to present something, so some topic came to my mind, and there are some of the slides with me earlier. So So, but later when he gave me the flyer, I saw that it is about the basics of the pain management. I think it was a day or 2 days, maybe 2 days ago. Nevertheless, I'm not covering something very hi-fi. So let me start with, so I have no conflicts of interest, nothing to disclose here. So basically, in the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about what ultrasound, how ultrasound has changed, not only the regional anesthesia, but also in the management of the chronic pain, okay, in the last 2 decades, actually, in the last 15 years, okay. So when it comes to nerve block, regional anesthesia to anesthesiologist, it means, okay, a lot of varieties of block needles, echogenic, non-echogenic needles, local anesthetics, the ultrasound machine, nerve stimulator, and various other adjuvant that we have been doing, either epinephrine, dexamethasone, kind of getting everyone's favorite, some maybe other, you know, like alpha 2 agonists, like clonidine, dexmedetomidine, kind of that. So when it comes to, and then depositing the medicine at the right place, at the right target, it can be interfacial plane, it can be neuraxial, or can be a plexus block. So what it means, so with ultrasound to a pain specialist, it's a little different. You know, we kind of use almost the same needles, the spinal needles, sometimes use block needles as well. The local anesthetic, almost same, the lidocaine, the bupivacaine, rupivacaine. But we are very fond of one thing, with steroid, okay? The, you know, depot steroids, or maybe like even if dexamethasone is non-depot steroid as well. Okay, so that kind of forms one of the bread and butter of chronic pain medicine. It used to be and still continues to be one of the practice, but what exactly, what is new? That is what I'm going to talk about in the next few minutes. Okay, and again, the target around the different areas. So in the initial years of ultrasound in pain medicine, US PM is ultrasound in pain medicine. So like in 2003, 2004, and then in 2010, 2012 also, the initial first 10 decades, it was all about describing the technical description of the various blocks. It can be nerve blocks, it can be flexors, a kind of joint, tendon, bursa, all those. So it was all about finding technical description, how to do, and then subsequent cadaveric studies, you know, to find out, to validate those studies, okay? So like here you can see this in the neck, cervical facet joint, this nerve block injections, again a stellate ganglion block, the lumbar facets, ilioinguinal, meralgia, parasitic, all those. So all these 10 years they went through these kind of techniques. But what is new? In recent times, we have kind of almost, though new techniques continue to evolve, like small nerves, tiny nerves, you know, nerve innervation into the major joints, ultrasound, the denervation technique. But in recent times, what was described some 10 years ago, we have come up with some solid data, okay? When it comes to ultrasound guided intervention, how safe? It is all about the safety. Ultrasound, is it safe to do ultrasound guided block compared to fluoroscopy or blind? Is the outcome different? Does it change the performance time? Does it affect the outcome also? Those things have come up in last few years, okay? So I'm going to cover basic role of the ultrasound in 3 aspects. One is going to be the musculoskeletal pain, nerve pain, and spine, okay? So it is not possible to cover everything in one small lecture, but I'll just touch base what exactly the new things that is happening around in the last few years, okay? So when you talk about ultrasound, it is about the target. Okay, whenever a patient comes to us in the clinic, we have ultrasound machine next to us, patient's chronic shoulder pain, we just scan and see, you know, we do a physical examination, history, and then something comes to our mind. Okay, is it the AC joint? Is it the rotator cuff pathology? It is RAC capsulitis kind of joint pathology, you know, and then based on that clinical history and examination, the next target, next thing becomes, where exactly the pain is coming, or in pain terminology, we call the pain generator. Okay, what is the etiology? Where exactly the pain is coming from? So in that case, the ultrasound comes a big way. We just quickly put the probe there. It helps to see us. Okay, the cough is fine. So there is no tendon. There is no tendon tear. No tendinosis. That kind of the bursa is fine. Okay, so that gives us instant finding in the clinic itself. And most number of PMR guys, rheumatologists, you know, and some of the pain physicians also, you know, in the clinic, they're using it more and more to get an accurate idea and data about, especially about the musculoskeletal pain. Okay, that is how it helps in the target or the pain generator. Okay, and the injected, what exactly, local anesthetic and steroid. As I told, we have moved beyond our kind of, there are many things that have come up in recent years where the injected have changed also in terms of chronic pain management, and then beyond examination. These three things I'll discuss in the next few slides. Target, the target again, it can be joints, okay. I remember in the beginning years, maybe like in the pain practice here, in my beginning years, the most of the pain focus was in the spine pain, okay, reticulopathy, pathogen pain, neck pain, all those kind of. But in recent times, it has changed. We are seeing more and more of shoulder pain, knee pain, all those kind of MSK conditions, you know, lateral epicondylitis, you know, plantar fasciitis, trigger finger, heel pain. So the target, of course, has changed only from the spine, now drifting towards more of MSK. So when you want to do an MSK thing, so you need to be proficient with ultrasound. The target joint, tendon, ligament, okay, muscles also, myofascial pain is a big thing, bursa, okay. So these targets, ultrasound helps in identifying many targets and look for the pain generators as well. Okay, and then injected, okay. So local anesthetic, steroid, that again still continues to be the bulk of the practice, but other things have come up in recent years, you know, Botox, disco supplements, prolotherapy, neurolytic agent, and even also now in recent times, regenerative therapy like biologics, platelet rich plasma. Okay, so I'll just quickly touch this upon these things, how ultrasound has changed the dynamics. Okay, so look at the Botox, you know, out of many things, it has been used for joint arthritis, for neuropathic pain, for MSK pain conditions. But out of all these things, the so far good evidence is for migraine, okay, chronic daily migraine, refractory migraine, or chronic daily headache. And the second thing is dystonia. Other things, there are kind of case reports, case series, some retrospective studies, some kind of prospective ones, not a good amount of data to suggest. But again, so it has been found. Suppose in this report here, so you have to do a piriformis injection Botox for a lot of gluteal pain, either a piriformis, you know, or maybe like obturator internus, or even ischiofemoral pain syndrome, like you have to do injection in the quadratus femoris. So all these injections, suppose if you want to do, and has been found to be effective also, when you do a single diagnostic injection and then subsequently a Botox injection, there is no way you can deposit accurately the medication. Of course, there is a fluoroscopic description of how to do that piriformis. But if you talk about the safety, avoiding the neurovascular structures, blood vessels, you know, and accurately depositing and, you know, avoiding the radiation exposure, there is nothing will match the ultrasound. Okay, so this is where it comes to. Here again, Botox in the migraine, of course, for these migraines, you don't need ultrasound. Similarly, like in the neuropathic conditions also, you know, these are randomized trials, it has been found to be effective. But again, the injections is around subcutaneous in most of the neuropathic pain condition. Next comes like visco supplement. This is like a high molecular weight, you know, pre-filled syringe that medication comes that we use mainly for the joints. Knee osteoarthritis is a common indication. Of course, it has been used in other conditions like, you know, hips, sometimes in ankle also. But the best evidence so far is for the knee. Of course, if one looks for the literature, there is a bit of heterogeneity in terms of the outcome, in terms of relief, duration of the pain relief. It all depends on how the injection was done, how frequently, in what stage of arthritis was it done. So I'll talk about one of the recent papers. This was in Journal of Ultrasound Medicine 2019. Okay, this talks about rethinking the visco supplement. Okay, so here what they did, around more than 1,000 patients underwent this knee intra-articular visco supplement injection in the United States. So a little more than half of the patients underwent a landmark guided, and around 500 underwent ultrasound guided knee injection. Okay. So they were analyzed for the degree of arthritis, body mass index, and then their chance for getting a knee arthroplasty subsequently. All these patients were followed for around 5 to 6 years. So what they found, out of 1146, 462 underwent knee arthroplasty. Okay, so they found that the cohort where the ultrasound-guided hyaluronic acid injection was done, less number of patients underwent TKR compared to landmark-guided cohort. Again, the subgroup analysis, there was no, they included all group of the patients, including patients with moderate obesity also. So they found in the obese patients also, there was a significant difference. Now, 34.8% patients in the obese group who underwent ultrasound-guided, they underwent TKR, whereas 51% underwent TKR in the landmark-guided. So they concluded that hyaluronic acid is a good thing for the intra-articular injection. It is about the accurate needle placement. And here comes the role of the ultrasound in ensuring the accurate needle placement and delivery, efficacious delivery of the medicine in the right place. So this is what that made the difference. Okay, so now moving ahead. Next is prolotherapy. Prolotherapy is basically they're like highly irritant substances, like it can be a 5% dextrose prolotherapy, it can be like sodium maurate or kind of glycerin, all those things. So there basically has been used in recent times in various musculoskeletal pain, neuropathic pain, and joint also, which kind of variable result, but good amount of evidence is building up in recent times that they're also pretty effective and can be considered as an alternative in various pain conditions. Okay. So these are again one of those systematic reviews highlighting its role in various conditions. But for that to happen, so one has to deposit the medication in the right place. And for that, again, the ultrasound is the best thing. Now comes the neurolytic agent, like phenol or alcohol. We have been using this in the cancer pain, like celiac places, hypogastric, or even in the ganglion impara, also various malignant patients. But this also has been used in other non-malignant conditions, like in one condition is like a Morton's neuroma. It's kind of a neuroma typically seen in the third wave space over here. And you can see as I move, this is that comes out. Okay, one of the treatment for this Morton's neuroma, when you do it. So this is what that pops out between the two wave space. We do something called Mulder test. When you do that, patient pain is reproduced and one can see this is that coming out. So one of the treatment for this is injection of the local anesthetic and subsequently alcohol neurolysis of that neuroma. So again, if you just think about how precisely you can deposit that alcohol, this high concentration alcohol, it can have, damage the surrounding innocent tissues. So for a precise delivery, again, ultrasound is the key. The final part, again, this has been used in chemical neurosis in some of these non-malignant conditions like, metastatic spread to the hip joint and even if like malignant pain where it is difficult to relieve the pain with other modalities or patient is not possible to undergo surgery. So again, this is a paper published in Anesthesia Analgesia. In a recent description with the pain block, so far we know these are the targets for the articular branches of the femoral, accessory obturator, nerve. So precise delivery of the tiny amount of neurolytic agent can be made to provide relief in patients who suffer from intractable pain and more specifically those who are inoperable. Okay, and we have another paper from our Indian authors, Arif Ahmad, who published for the knee arthritis also in a subgroup of patient advanced arthritis, not amenable to surgery, kind of not wanting to go for surgery also. Okay. So, and the next thing comes, the happening thing in the recent times in the pain medicine is the biologic stem cells or the PRP. Okay, so we all know that they reach in the platelet, the platelets are rich in the growth factors like vascular endothelial growth factor, platelet direct growth factor, all those kind of growth factors which helps in regenerative thing, and it has been found to be useful in many conditions. Tendinosis, tendinopathies, ligaments, arthritis, cartilages. And for all this, again, so the best thing is about ultrasound. So there is suppose you want to do deposit the local anesthetic. And of course, there is alternative like fluoroscopy can use for the joints. But again, suppose if you want to avoid the neurovascular structure, so there is no way ultrasound can match. You can see that when you inject a dye there. With ultrasound, that can be avoided. That can be completely avoided also. So now, next is beyond injection. What exactly beyond injection we do? So alternative things in nerve pain, and also in the MSK pain conditions. So let us talk about few important things that we have been doing in recent times is in nerve neuropathic pain condition, nerve decompression. So this is again one of the common nerve decompression that happens is the carpal tunnel syndrome. That is the commonest compressive neuropathy that happens. So what we have been doing is surgical release. Okay, surgical open surgery, or of course there are others like, you know, even if there is like what is that? Similar to laparoscopy also, they put kind of mini surgeries are there. But then with ultrasound guided carpal tunnel release is one of the new things that has been happening in last 7 to 10 years. Again, with ultrasound guided, you see the transverse carpal ligament, which encircles and compresses the median nerve there. You put the needle and then multiple approach, you do kind of make a tent in the deeper part of the transverse carpal ligament and release the nerve. This has been found to be pretty effective, and this was the initial description in 2013. And in subsequent years, the technique has been refined and newer things have been come out. This is one paper in 2 years ago. So here, they're using a hook knife. Okay, one can see in the left side figure, this is the hook knife. Okay, so once you give the local anesthetic, one can see the surgical scar, you know, it's a small scalpel blade with ultrasound guidance in the long axis to the course of the nerve. So there is a safe zone. Okay, I'll see that in the next slide. So you put the this hook and you just release carpal transverse carpal ligament. And that way, so this is paper, one can see here, this is the median nerve. M is the median nerve. And this arrowhead is the transverse carpal ligament or the flexor retinaculum. Okay, so this is the artery over here. Okay, so this is the ulnar artery here. Okay, and so this is the hook knife that has been put. One can see the short axis scanning here. That is the hook knife. Okay, and this has been changed to the long axis. In the long axis, we can see that hook knife. And arrowhead shows that is just below, this is the transverse carpal ligament. Okay, so this is just below the transverse carpal ligament. So you pull that, and with contraction, multiple pull, and you release that subsequently. So this is what, these are the, you know, at the end, you see, these are the two, you know, torn heads of the carpal ligament. And this is the decompressed median nerve at the end of the procedure. So this can be done with ultrasound guided with just a small needle. Faster recovery. In this study, they conducted around 124 patients and they followed them for 6 to 12 months. Fantastic. All complete release in all 100% of patients with excellent relief of symptoms and no complications. So this is what ultrasound has helped us in recent times. Okay. So moving ahead, next is in the nerve pain management also, another thing that has come up is hydrodissection. Okay, so basically with hydrodissection, what it means that you inject some medication. It can be local anesthetic, it can be steroid, it can be dextrose, like some prolotherap like dextrose. It can be only saline also, or even PRP. Okay, so when nerve is compressed, like in the case of carpal tunnel also, or maybe neuralgia paresthetica, in different locations it can be compressed, it can be cubital tunnel, median nerve, here in the Guyon's canal you can have the ulnar nerve also. So all these locations where the nerve get compressed, we can employ, if it is not a severe compression requiring a surgical, you can always do a hydrodissection in the beginning. So ultrasound helps not only in the diagnosis also. We now have a carpal tunnel syndrome ultrasound diagnostic criteria. So ultrasound helps in the dynamic scan and looking for other pathologies. There can be a ganglion, there can be cyst, there can be tenosynovitis, which might be compressing the nerve. So ultrasound helps in diagnosis of all those things which can otherwise be missed if only a nerve conduction study is used to identify the compressive neuropathy. So in hydrodissection, basically inject this medicine under pressure just below, just around the nerve, below that compressive area, or maybe some fibrous tissue also, you know, post-surgical, you know, scarring there. So that, you know, whenever there's a compression, that leads to, you know, decreased blood supply to that area. Lymphatic drainage is kind of reduced around the nerve. So that becomes sensitized. So you kind of release all those things after doing a hydrodissection. Okay. So this is how the fluid goes around. So this is basically anti-inflammatory medications like prolotherapy, steroids, or even PRP also has been found to be effective. This slide again shows, this is the superficial median nerve after one of the surgery getting entrapped here as it perforates and comes out of the tendon over here at the distal wrist. Okay, So this is Brachyrhodalis, just about to pierce Brachyrhodalis and coming out. So this is how needle goes there. You kind of deposit local on and above and do a hydrodal section. This is one of the patients recent times I did. This is like a carpal tunnel syndrome. This big swollen nerve there just below the transverse carpal ligament, flexor retinaculum. And this is my needle going just on the top of the nerve. So this is the flexor retinaculum, just on just below the flexor retinaculum on the nerve. I'm kind of doing a hydrodal section and release. And one can see at the end of the procedure, so these are all my medication, a bit of local anesthetic and some steroid surrounding the nerve all around. So these are all flexor tendons. So this is how ultrasound helps in precise direction of the needle and do the procedure. Okay, so this is how we look at this video. So this is the big swollen median nerve. In fact, this patient, interestingly, had a nerve conduction study done and it was normal, though he was diagnosed with a carpal tunnel because the symptoms are typical. See, now I'm kind of hydrodissecting just below, depositing a little bit below, but I'll just go on the top also. I had done the top part, came down to below, and this video was taken towards the latter part. Okay, so interestingly, this was the nerve conduction study was normal. The nerve diameter was some 24 millimeter square. We now know that if it is more than 12 or 14 millimeter square, it is severe symptoms in the dispatient anomalies. You can see now, so my local anesthetic medication just releasing from the transverse carpal ligament of the flexor retinaculum. So this is the nerve, big swollen nerve there and needle. So these all things are possible thanks to the ultrasound only. So without ultrasound, you know, you just can never deposit in the right place. That area is surrounded by a lot of tendons. You know, you can inject into a tendon, which can be excruciatingly painful. And if you inject any steroid into a tendon, that can rupture also. The final part, when it comes about the nerve management, now about the RF ablation, you know, you talk about the genicular blocks in the knees and the hips also. Here, that helps, you know, in the initial description was fluoroscopy guided. In the subsequent times, it helps us all the genicular arteries and precise placement of the RF cannula and carrying out the RF ablation also. Now, coming to tendon-related pain management, you know, we can have tendon tear, tendinosis, tendinopathy, and calcific tendons also. So all these, again, possible with ultrasound. So tennis elbow is another common cause of inflammation and pain. So with ultrasound, one can precisely diagnose. You know, we look for the signs also. We can again see if the tendon is normal, if there is a loss of, you know, tear also, or there is the, you know, partial or complete tear also. This all can be identified with, and even if calcification also, that can be identified. So, and then needed, you can do a fenestration and injection, like, you know, you can break the calcification, multiple fenestration, and inject like biologics like PRP or even autologous blood also has been found to be helpful in lateral epicondylitis also. Okay, so another thing is calcific tendinitis, which is common in the shoulder, supraspinatus shoulders, calcific tendinitis. So here we do a fenestration, barbotase, and this final part is the suboptimal bursa injection. Basically, one can see this like this, you know, calcific deposition that needs to be aspirated, you know, otherwise the patient will have continued pain. So this is how you put a needle there with pressure and kind of rotate it, then with continuous saline injection, then aspirate the content. And as the content comes out, it can significantly irritate the subacromial bursa and pain also. So we do not forget to inject in the subacromial bursa. I think this is a slide just showing Barbotase technique. So this is the needle going into that calcification part. And then with pressure, we try to get into the that calcification, and then you rotate, break the content inside, and then inject saline and aspirate also. So that initial part is, you know, breaking and going into that part of the calcification. It depends on what type of calcification it is. Is it too hard? Sometimes it can be very difficult also to get into that. So, and then you inject with some saline, create pressure. This procedure is extremely painful. This procedure is very, very painful. So we do the patient under a block, you know, a bit of interscalene or kind of suprascapular nerve block, and then do that also. Very, very painful. And then at the end, we do this subacromial bursa injection to finish the procedure. So so just to conclude, so all this means at the end, so we do the target, injected, the therapy is changing, you know, we're looking beyond other things like biologics, prolotherapy, and at the end, it is all about the functional relief. You know, patient going back to the work. So that is the motto. Okay, so things are changing. The injected or viscous supplement, prolotherapy, and for everything, there is a huge role of ultrasound, not only directing the pain physician to deposit the medication or the agents at the right place, but also carrying out the procedure very efficaciously without significant complication. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Rajendra. It was a really nice, crisp talk. Can you stop your screen sharing?
Okay, I'll stop. Okay, I saw that. Stop here. Okay, yes.
Dr. Salish.
Yep.
Yeah. Basically, there are a few questions in the chat box, which we will finish. Then I have got a few questions for you. So the first question, which has come from Dr. Shlok Saxena, can you advise doing a ilioinguinal nerve neurectomy to prevent the development of chronic pain in mesh hernioplasty patients?
It's not advisable because there is no, as we saw, one of those slides said that actually when you cut the nerve, there is also incidence of increased post-surgical pain. And also when you try to identify the nerve, the problem is that when you you're teaching it and then you are stretching the nerve, you're pulling the nerve and doing that, you are fiddling with the nerve. Then also the chronic chances of chronic post-surgical nerve, chronic post-surgical pain increases. I think the best bit to do is this thing that leave the nerve, particularly with ilioinguinal genitofemoral thing, is to leave the nerve as it is and then to try and kind of do the mesh referral and other things.
Yeah.
So that's the.
You told about the role of perioperative ketamine and lidocaine in prevention of post-surgical pain. So there's a question related to that from Dr. Prashant Lomate. You regularly advise or give perioperative ketamine and lidocaine infusion in patient in surgeries where you are doing only under regional anesthesia?
No, this is you're talking of surgeries which are more than 2 hours long, surgeries which are complicated, and regional anesthesia has its own advantage. And if you give perioperative ketamine, then even though the induction dose of the ketamine is 1 to 2 milligrams per kg and you are giving half a milligram, you're likely to make them very sleepy to the point where almost like adding to their sedation thing. So, but you can give magnesium. You can give magnesium if you're attacking the NMDA receptor. So instead of ketamine, you can look for magnesium. You can give them periop, one dose of pregabalin, 75 milligram, I would say. And then if you think, see, somebody going through a vascular surgery, somebody going through an amputation, somebody going through a surgery that is clearly in the path of a nerve, ilioinguinal, genitofemoral, and also complex hip operation, complex knee operation, you could probably give them pregabalin, 75 twice daily, I would keep for 4 to 5 days. So that what is happening is pregabalin, I'm not working for Pfizer, I'm not working for any company, but I'm just saying that pregabalin has become almost a lifestyle medicine. It reduces your anxiety. It gives you a little bit of sleep that you people, it is crucial for people to get in those couple of 3-4 days around the time of operation. And there is a role in reducing chronic post-surgical pain. So to answer your question, not ketamine, not lidocaine. Again, that is just complicated things if you're doing it on a regional. But definitely think of magnesium and think of the gabapentinoids. So gabapentin, lot of dose adjustment. Pregabalin is just a newer and easy to titrate. That's why I've stopped using gabapentin.
Yeah. Basically, out of all the surgeries which you had talked, where the chances of post-surgical pain are much higher, the three surgeries like total knee replacement, hysterectomies, and breast, they have the highest incidence of chronic post-surgical pain. And since TKR being a lifestyle modification operation where you have got a post-surgical incidence pain of around 25%. So what is your regimen which you practice in TKR patients so that they don't have that chronic post-surgical pain part?
So, okay, good. So basically, optimization, first of all, expectation, early ambulation. Sometimes people are starting physiotherapy on day zero, but realistically, even day one, most of the places would do physiotherapy in day one of TKR. Then you are telling them that actually we're going to fix the knee, but also you need to build up your muscle around the knee by doing the physiotherapy. That is key part. I would knowing the surgeon, you know that your surgeon can operate within 1-1.5 hour, or if the surgeon is slow, taking 3 hours, then that is tricky. Then you have to adjust whether to do a spinal or a CSI, combined spinal epidural. You're doing that. Then you can add up with spinal with also nerve blocks to give pain relief. Parenterally, I think if the patient is a bit anxious, has got other issues, I would say consider something like pregabalin, like 50 to 75 milligram twice daily for 3 days, just for 3 days, starting from the day of the surgery in the morning or the night before. Or if not, even a small dose of amitriptyline or nortriptyline, 10 milligram, with that will take time. The amitriptyline will not kick in so quickly as pregabalin. It will take time to kick in. And you're doing your regional, you're trying to avoid opioids as much as you can, but and then early ambulation and paracetamol and ibuprofen, something like non-steroidal for 3 days, and then take it from there. Yeah.
Okay. And what can about?
Can I add one
thing? Yeah, please, Rajendra. Please. Sorry. You can. Please.
Only thing is that, Salil sir, what you said perfectly fine. So, lot of literature in the Western literature about all those gabapentin, pregabalin. Even with all those 2010, 2008 studies, they came up, they all gave 75 BD, or even if pregabalin of 600 or 600, kind of, yeah. 800. Yeah. So as a pain physician, we all know, we all start, in our patients, even if you're 50 milligram with some 60, yeah. 65 year patient that you give,
it's too much.
They sleep like hell. Okay. Yeah. And like some of the surgeons will be tricky. They want to just make them walk the next day, or maybe they make them want to make them stand in the same day evening. So this patient may feel dizzy, kind of sleepy out of the pregabalin effect also. So I think in our patient group, I think possibly 50 or 75, maybe can start 5 or 7 days before.
Yeah, you know, I'm definitely not suggesting 150. In fact, pregabalin comes in 25 as well. So if you're worried you are worried about a 70-year-old lady who owes only 40, 45 kilo, not even 50, starts with 25. So yeah. Absolutely.
We have a few companies, they have that 25 also. So because the patients, otherwise they'll feel sleepy, kind of dizzy also. Unfortunately, some of them, if they do fall in the ward out of the pregabalin, that can be disastrous also.
No, that's the other thing to tell participants here, is that actually pregabalin is associated with increased risk of fall. And obviously, daytime sedation, whatever pain management you are doing, daytime sedation is bad. So we don't want to. So therefore, another approach could be you take 25 or 50 in the morning and you take 50 or 75 in the night.
Yeah. Knee replacement TKR patients, you have got that preoperative chronic pain component. So the you advise pregabalin. But what about the breast surgeries and hysterectomies? What is your regimen to prevent that?
So breast surgery, it has been seen that the paravertebrals have actually made a big difference in breast surgery. Paravertebral blocks, the good articles now coming up saying that regional anesthesia in erector spinae block or paravertebral block, and those things are coming in. And I do a simple, very simple procedure called intercrural block. So basically raising the hand, going in the mid-axillary line, and then actually doing intercrural block. That is very effective, and it is just loss of resistance to saline, just using a Tuohy needle, and you spread basically 20 ml of 0.25% in the thing, and that you could do it under asleep when the patient is asleep. Effective and does the job. So
You talked about paravertebral. Obviously, to be very frank, if the number of participants who are there, if I tell them to give a paravertebral block, I think hardly 1 or 2% will go for a paravertebral block because of the advanced level, even with the ultrasound.
Yeah,
coming to the erector spinae, the blockade of the ventral rami is still under question, right?
Yeah, it is spine is inferior.
Yeah. So what about the chest wall block, which does it help in preventing chronic post-surgical pain?
And I mean, only block that they have looked into it is the paravertebral. I haven't known actually gestural block, but the practices vary. If you know where your surgeon is going to do the incision, what extent you are doing, and you know we know our neuroanatomy, I mean, where the intercostals are going, which layers are going, then right. Any nerve you can design. I think once you have a team, you know, this is the surgeon, this is the incision, and this is what they do, you can tailor make it. I mean, you know, these are the 3-4 types block. This patient, this will work.
Yeah. So, regarding the hysterectomy, many people practice, obviously you give a abdominal block for the upper lap ports and everything. But one thing which we follow is intraperitoneal instillation of local anesthetic after the vault is closed. Does it help in preventing that chronic post-surgical?
That's exactly. That is routinely advised. Again, just here is the point to the participants that surgeons often go back to 0.5 bupivacaine. But, you know, for sensory block, we only need 0.25. So if you give dilute and bigger volume, you are getting a bigger, wider thing. So you don't have to give 0.5. Just 0.25 is good enough.
Okay. Thank you very much. Rajendra, there are a few questions for you. There's a question from Dr. Vinita Sharma. What are the agents which you used for your hydro dissection and how long it is effective?
Well, that's a good one. So I told in my presentation also, the agents that we use can be local anesthetic alone, with or without steroid. We can add some prolotherapy like dextrose also, 5% or 12.5% dextrose. One can use PRP also. Okay, so these are the basically agents for hydro dissection. How long it is effective, again, depends on the pathology and the severity of the disease. Okay. Like the one I showed in the video, that patient is straightforward a surgical candidate. Okay. The patient came to me for the first time, I was suffering for a long and didn't want any surgery at this time. So I did that, you know, and she got pain relief. It will last for maybe few months or so, you know, with decreased pain. And then possibly when he comes back, I'll counsel that. Okay, so coming to one of the trial that has been done for the carpal tunnel syndrome, they included from mild to moderate intensity severity of the carpal tunnel in terms of cross-sectional area diagnostic criteria, and they used one group used saline which was done a subcutaneous injection. The study group, they got prolotherapy 5% dextrose, and they followed them patients for 6 months. And around 70% of the patients, they did had continuity of pain relief at 6 month follow up also. Okay, so that is one study. And I will say on an average, we get 2 to 6 months of pain relief, you know, depending on where you do and what type of conditions that you do also.
So what is your criteria to select patient with carpal tunnel syndrome? When do you advise surgery and when do you inject? It's a question from Dr. Shweta.
Well, for the carpal tunnel, the mild and moderate symptoms, of course, you know, I do have ultrasound in the clinic, and those who agree for it, we do the hydro dissection in the clinic itself. Okay, for the mild and moderate symptoms. Those who have severe symptoms in terms of symptom, like, you know, numbness, you know, or maybe like severe, like atrophy of the muscles, so the thinner muscles, you know, clear cut, identifiable. So those things, you know, I send them for the surgery. In some of the patient, like surgical candidates who are not willing for surgery, they want kind of some temporary quick relief at least to do things also. Recent times I did a couple of doctors also in Durgapur also, he was wife of orthopedic surgeon, gynecologist, so scared of surgery. And moreover, because of the COVID time, they didn't want to go for surgery also. They wanted some kind of, you know, at least some temporary relief so that they can continue their activities. So it all varies, you know, whenever it is a surgical candidate, you just give all the information. See, so what you are doing, some temporary, you may or may not get any pain relief for maybe like few days or weeks also. This is kind of minimally invasive with ultrasound guidance, almost no complication. If you want to go ahead, you can do that. Okay, so this is how, like, you know, anything. So injector, you can use only local anesthetic, you can combine with a bit of steroid, or you can give prolotherapy. You know, there are studies also, they do prolotherapy 5% dextrose injection on a 2-week interval, 2 or 3 times. And that also kind of they claim to add up the duration of the benefit also.
So in resistance cases, resistant cases, do you advise injection of alcohol in your trigger points?
Trigger points, no. I've never done that, and I don't think trigger point, you know, alcohol is a solution to the trigger points also. It's basically dry needling, or you just, you know, I think recently there is a paper published a few days ago on the, you know, steroid effect looking for the myofascial pain conditions. No, we do local anesthetic, dry needling, or steroid, or maybe like Botox, but not alcohol, you know, no.
So you do your maximum pain procedures in OPD basis. So what is the minimum investigations and monitoring which you advise to all the participants?
Well, no investigations.
Okay.
Okay. So, well, in the other room, we do have, you know, oxygen and we do have a pulse oximeter also, and access to the emergency drugs also. I have arranged that. But routinely, we kind of do not use monitor. But of course, you know, if it's there, you should put a pulse oximeter ECG. But pretty much they are fairly like, you know, superficial things. Like suppose a myalgia paresthetica, a knee joint injection, a carpal tunnel, trigger finger, you know, tennis elbow, sometimes, you know, tendo Achilles, plantar fascia injections. So those are the things pretty much superficial. So, but we have access to everything, you know, resuscitation drugs, oxygen, those kind of stuff are there. So we don't do any procedure unless the patient is on any kind of dual antiplatelet or taking some anticoagulant. So I have to think, you know, I have to weigh for the benefit and ratio if my procedure is going to cause a lot of bleeding there, hematoma there. So in the otherwise, I don't do any investigation.
Do you advise keeping intralipid in the in your pain clinic?
Well, so my practice has been I always use lidocaine. Lidocaine means Xylocard, preservative free. Okay, so preservative free lidocaine, and that too I use 1%. All the procedures that we do, perineural, joint, bursa, we hardly used a couple of ml, 2, 3, 4, 5 ml. So I don't, you know, even if that 5 ml, 1% lidocaine goes intravenous with ultrasound also I do, I don't expect anything to happen to the patient. You know, we use that 1 to 1, 1.5 milligram per kilo bolus IV dose, you know, perineural, perioperative also, you know, as Dr. Mishra was telling. So, you know, yes, intralipid is not there because, and I'm careful with ultrasound. I see, always make sure that, you know, whenever I don't see the tip or even if not seeing spread of my injected, I stop it there. But you know, if one can keep that, it's a good idea. It's not bad.
But, will you advise as a part of a protocol?
Well, I think it is not bad. I think it's not bad. As yeah, I told, I use lidocaine.
Yeah, please. Yeah,
sorry. Yeah, no, that's fine. So basically, just to be absolutely clear to all the participants here, when you are doing this, one, remember one thing, that we are dealing with local anesthetics and it can go into wrong places. So as Rajendra's technique, what he has done is this. Basically, he has ruled out the cardiotoxicity local anesthetic. So he's not using bupivacaine at all. So even if he goes, I know IV lidocaine 100 milligram, if you give through 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg, so probably you will get away with that, and that's fine. And obviously, he's doing it on ultrasound, that is all safe. But if you are developing the service, be very clear that your whole hospital license would be at risk if you don't actually put have the processor to do resuscitation within seconds. So at least, if not in that room, the next room, you should have at least the resuscitation medication, life-saving medication, adrenaline, airway resuscitation bag. Because I was a trainee in AIMS, and my consultant was doing steroid gangrene block in outpatient. And we did not even see the blood at the tip of the blue needle, the 23-gauge needle. And before I know, the patient started convulsing. Straight away started convulsing. So therefore, and then all you have to do is just lift the jaw up and it subsided in a few seconds. So I have seen local anesthetic toxicity. I've seen stillet people convulsing. And therefore, when you are starting, start with the right foot up in the correct way. And therefore, when you're setting up a service, if not in the next area, at least you know where bupivacaine would be, where the interlipid would be there if you're going to use bupivacaine. But Rajendra, what he has done, that's right. I mean, he's just ruled out bupivacaine.
Please, Rajendra.
To add one more thing, just for that sake of getting into the complications, I have completely declined to people in small nursing homes, in some stores also where I see it, you know, they'll request, sir, would you have ultrasound machine? So I never injected, you know, just for the sake of fear in the back of my mind, if any complication happens, you know, I don't have anything here. Leave about all those air equipment. I don't have anything, access to oxygen only. Okay. So this is like an in-house hospital, tertiary, we kind of, everything is there. We have the emergency department just there, you know, a couple of blocks, you know, a few steps away from the clinic, so we can quickly take it there. We have the access to OR itself. So make sure that you have everything is there. You know the resuscitation, you have everything there, you know. So that is one thing. Okay, still it, though I can do that, you know, in a couple of minutes, we can do it in the clinic itself. I don't do stillets in the OPD. So I just take to them, you know, not in the OR, I take them to the preoperative holding area, and under monitoring, I get it done there, you know. So just to be on the safer side.
Yeah, Dr. Shailesh. Basically, we were talking about prevention. Now a patient comes to you already with a chronic post-surgical pain. So how to go about it?
Okay, first thing is, then you're talking of the chronic pain territory. Chronic pain territory, then I think the first thing is, sometime if you just explain the patient, I have had a patient who had a scission section 20 years back. Her daughter is already 20 years old, and she has got, basically they had, it was an emergency section, baby was turning, deteriorating. So they just went through, zipped through, and then took out the baby. And then since then, she's been having this discomfort, and she has been on a lot of depression drugs, all that, this thing. And all this sometimes is need to know is the, what is causing it? So explanation, first thing is explanation. There is a pain, there is some hyperalgesia, some paresthesia, some allodynia in the nerve distribution. That nerve is likely to be involved in that procedure, and the pain has started. Pain was not there before the procedure. The pain has kind of started after the procedure and has kept on for months and months and months. This is chronic post-surgical pain. So we say that actually, if we give them explanation, that itself has a big therapeutic value for patients. They understand. Then these are all neuropathic pain. You see their sleep. You see their mood. Sleep and pain are very closely related. If people are not getting 5-6 hours of sleep at night, then the pain is kind of taking over their life in the daytime. So a simple regimen, people don't like taking medicine. So I would say, instead of gabapentin and pregabalin, I would go for amitriptyline, nortriptyline, or duloxetine, any of those three at one dose at bedtime, just to help them with sleep. And with neuropathic pain relief also. So you're not giving them a sleeping pill, you're giving them a nerve pain medicine that is likely to help with sleep. Then the other thing is physiotherapy. Now, depending upon which part and where it is, some just explanation that it is okay to continue, you will not do yourself any harm, go for your walks, do your things, keep yourself active, that sort of thing. And then occasionally when flare-ups occur, resort to some anti-inflammatory, very occasionally use, and they're really, really bad and struggling in winter cold months, and then give them an opioid, but use opioid, not long acting, no patches, no long acting preparation, only for rescue medicine and for a brief period. So
what's the role of lidocaine patch in chronic?
Yeah, so lidocaine patch is basically if the area is hypersensitive and there is hyperalgesia to touch. So if the skin, so lidocaine patch was approved here for post-operative neuralgia, because that was a model of circumscribed neuropathic pain. But a lot of time they have rib cage, so post-thoracotomy pain, ilioinguinal pain, and yes, you can use knee pain. I have a lot of happy customers of knee pain. They have got bad knee pain even after the surgery. Lidocaine plaster, yes, you can use. It's a costly thing, therefore here it is, they don't prescribe it that much unless we have to really have an indication. But if the skin is sensitive, then that is likely to help. But don't give lidocaine plaster for back pain. That is not a very good treatment strategy. Localized pain, so yes, so mastectomy pain, knee pain, so that sort of thing, iloinguinal pain, yeah, it does work. Up to 2 plaster, 12 hour on, 12 hour off.
Thank you, Dr. Shailesh and Dr. Rajin Sao. It was just a fabulous talk, and the discussions part were amazing. And we have got very good feedbacks of both the talks from all the areas where it is being transmitted. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Now, I will hand over to the office bearers, Dr. Shovan, to carry forward the proceedings. Thank you.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Thank you, Itisbhai. Thank you.
Good evening, all. Now we'll have something about the branch. It's I think the slides are visible. Is that right?
It's visible.
Hello.
Am I audible? You are audible. It's
okay.
Visible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, the Society for the Study of Pain, Bhubaneswar, is basically a city branch of ISSP. And this branch was a necessity for Bhubaneswar, because not only Bhubaneswar, it was for Odisha, in fact, just to spread the knowledge about pain regarding acute and chronic and all sorts of pain and different modalities of procedures that they're doing under a banner, and that is for ISSP. And so last year we have formed this branch. This is the certificate of registration for the society. This is Society for the Study of Pain. This is at actually the address that has been given in plot number 15/1 Civic Center. And now these are the office bearers for the first time. The president is Professor Dr. Nivedita Pani. Vice president is Professor Dr. Ritesh Roy. Myself is the secretary. Treasurer is Dr. Gaurav Bhardwal. And GC members are like Dr. Jita Mitra Mishra, Chandrasekhar Pradhan, Dr. Bhaskar Rao, and Dr. Anita Panda. For the first, because the society has started working just for 1 year, so the first duration will be minimum for 3 years for the office bearers. Then we'll be changing the office bearers with proper election pattern. Now, other members who are there, these are the other members who are registered. Now, we want to increase the membership drive so that more and more members are included into the society, so that regularly we can do seminars and other things, so that we can spread the knowledge of pain to the anesthesiologists who are working in different sectors in Bhubaneswar as well as in all over the Odisha. Now, the incorporation of the society was done on 18th of January 2020. This is the registered office at Health Village Hospital. And as per the memorandum of article, we have to have our AGBM on second week of Jan every year. Now, the membership fee that is for the society is almost like 5,000. Out of that, 25% will be coming to the city branch. So we should increase the membership drive so that we'll have our own funds. And we're trying to incorporate few corporate members so that we'll have some funds for palliative care and other activities so that for their, for our social activities. And the next assignment for us, which was earlier in 2021, this year, February, ISSPCon 2021. Now, because of the COVID, it has been shifted to 2022. So we will require the assistance from all the members who are there, and those who are not being members now, I will request them to be members as soon as possible, and help us in conducting this National Conference of Pain in 2022, because it's a matter of pride for us. And we'll be continuing with such kind of webinars next year. And as Dr. Ritesh has already told, that we want this 2020 to complete, to go away, so that we have suffered a lot this year. And we hope that from next year onwards, it will bring a new day of hope for all of us. We have completed two webinars. The first one was for the basics of ultrasound, which was supported by Janssen, and the second was by Intas. And both the webinar series, we have got technical support from Sonosite and broadcasting support from Anesthesia TV. So we will be thankful to all the delegates, and we will welcome all the anesthesiologists who can be the member of Bhubaneswar City Branch. And I'll request all those who are present here to spread out this message to all our faculties in all over Odisha, so that we can increase the membership drive. Thank you.
Thank you, Sovan. Thank you. Does a great job. Thanks, guys.
Over to Dr. Gaurav for the concluding remarks. Dr. Gaurav.
Hello.
Yeah. Sovan, can you stop your screen sharing, please? Shobhan, stop your screen sharing, please.
Sir, we can close. No issue.
Yeah.
Stop typing.
No. Yeah, Gaurav, you continue.
Yeah, no issues. We can continue. Yeah, I would like to thank both our speakers, Dr. Shailesh and Dr. Rajendra, for an excellent talk. I would like to thank Professor Dr. Ritesh Roy for chairing this session. It was a very informative session and very excellent discussions. We had a lot of good feedback from all our portals, including Anesthesia TV, Pain TV, the Facebook page, as well as Zoom right now. So thank you so much. I would like to thank ISSP Bhuvaneshwar for this beautiful initiative we are doing to raise the city branch so that we can be prepared for the national program in 2022. And we would like to invite all our viewers from Bhuvaneshwar and Odisha to kindly join the city branch so that we can take it forward. And last but not least, I would like to thank Intas and Fujifilm Sonosite for the great support. And Rahul Chauve from Anesthesia TV for making this possible to stream it throughout the globe. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Gaurav. Thank you. Bye-bye. Take care. Be safe. Bye-bye.
Thank you very much.
Bye. Bye.